100% fan-funded film. Be prepared for independent thinking.
Do you know that feeling? When you come to a place you didn't know, don't understand, and no one explains where you are. But deep inside, your primal instinct tells you that we once were connected to a place as such. Because somewhere along the line, we simply evolved away from it. By ignorance, arrogance, or perhaps deliberately obscured. We became modern people, right? So smart that we've become stupid again. Not understanding the roots and principles of where we come from anymore. Symbols and structures with perhaps great meanings and connections, but in our present day existence, nothing more than a hollow space. Yes, nowadays we certainly build structures much bigger and more comfortable than where I am at the moment. But imagine building this thousands of years ago, in the middle of a mountain. It just makes me curious who we once were and why we're not anymore.
Look at down there, huge, massive boulders. You really want to understand how they lift the stones, how they move them. And this is the chamber in the ground floor. The rings of stone decrease in size. You see, smaller and smaller. And then, since you have another chamber on top, because the central tower used to have three chambers,
which era were these towers built?
Most of the Nuraghe Tower were probably erected around 1500 before Christ. So this was what we were told by the archaeologists anyway. This is the date of birth of all the 8,000 Nuraghe that still dot the Sardinian landscape. But the original estimation is around 30,000 in the original times. This is called the Valley of the Nuraghe. And look at how this window overlooks the other Nuraghe settlement. You see, they had these astronomical towers because these people were very knowledgeable in astronomy, metallurgy, more advanced than what you may think. I think the megalithism that you find in Europe, but also outside of Europe, think of Peru, think of Mexico, it has a relation, it's all connected. But scholars haven't concentrated their effort on studying these megalithic buildings. Mm? So they're still mysterious, particularly in Sardinia, where we are trying to understand more and more now. Mm? And since new theories have been coming up, new archaeological diggings that revealed the importance of a mysterious civilization like this. Definitely, these people were more advanced than we think.
Whoa.
We were in the human world, and now we're reaching another world, which is expressed in this type of sacred temples of the Nuragic civilization.
It's perfectly lined up.
Yes, the symmetry and the accuracy of these elaborated, very well hewn stones is amazing. You really wonder how they could precisely cut this basalt, which is a very hard volcanic stone, in a perfect way like this. It had a much more important value than a normal well, because these early inhabitants of the island probably associated the idea of water with the mother goddess. Water was a great source and resource. It could be therapeutical, it could heal, it could cure problems. And these places were very strongly, you know, energetic. And there are very strange phenomena that happens here during the solstices and the equinoxes. Like there's a hole right on top of the sacred well chamber. Can you see it? Mm-hmm. And the moon beams like a light, gets inside the well. Or during the solstice, at the beginning of fall, around 11 a.m., you can see your shadow reflected in the water, and in the wall you appear upside down. You know, because it's the subterranean world that they had to reach, this magical, powerful outer world, which is not, it's invisible, but it's to attract the universal forces. So these people really knew a lot of about energy, meditation, contemplation of the sky. I think we got very far away from that point. We're reaching this knowledge again, as we don't separate the body and the spirit. They were aware of that. They were in perfect contact with the sky. And we probably are, you know, dust that came from the sky. The name of this place is Sadome Sorkui, the home of the ogre. The theory that we have is different from what the academic world has proposed till now.
Oh, really?
These tombs have been described by the academic scholars are collective tombs, which means that there were burials used all over again to bury different people. Even if they refer to the heroes of this civilization, I don't know if it makes sense, because we've never seen pictures of the skeletons which were unearthed during the excavations. There's no record of that. But these were not just simple tombs. The chamber has a stone stole, like a little seat. They call it a meditation chair, used by, you know, young people passing from childhood to adulthood, where they had to sleep and stay in contact with the soul of their powerful ancestors inside the tomb of the giants. This is even told by the ancient Greeks. It was called the incubation rite. So sleeping, you know, in contact with the soul of the ancestors. The entrance is facing the east side, so the rising of the sun, which means the rebirth. So they were built according to astronomic rules that these people had the knowledge of. The sacred energetic place is not just tombs.
Sacred healing areas created through astronomic precision and connections. Nice. A little floaty, I must say. Almost spiritual, whatever that may be. Which I'm not exactly, I guess. But hey, I'm open to new information. And what isn't, can still come.
I think this civilization reached a real moment of a flourishing age. Very advanced in metallurgy, trading all over the Mediterranean, and then something happened that deleted the glorious past. And then the archaeologists didn't consider the importance of this civilization, neglected, misconsidered. So
on purpose or?
Probably also on purpose, because the theories that they would come up would be shocking. Would be shocking. Because there are...
For whom?
For the whole academic world. And also for the average human being. Because there are lots of mysteries about this island. Lots of strange legends about, ogre giants, little fairies. Lots of legends that need to be explained. This is the Church of Santa Anastasia, and it's incredible how this Catholic church was built on a pagan sacred well of the Nuragic Age, which is just outside where the remains of the Nuragic settlements were. So can you imagine the Catholic that continued building on top of some previous pagan temples? And it was here that at the beginning of the 20th century, it is said, and you can find it reported also in some articles, that apparently some huge skeletons were found that belonged to giant human beings.
Well, are you talking about giants?
Yeah, I'm talking about giant skeletons, yes.
Tall people?
Yeah, from 3 to 6 meters, this is what the articles report, because apparently, once they were unburied in the settlement of the Nuragic Age, then the skeleton were taken into this church, and then the day after, according to witnesses, they disappeared.
But who's taking them away?
They said some inspectors came. I don't know who they were. Don't know.
What could be a reason that they are hiding a huge story like that? What could be, other theories or?
Oh, yes. I mean, it would change the human history. So admitting that there was a time that this giant existed and probably ruled over the common people, it will change the history. How are you going to explain hundreds and hundreds of years that we were told it? This is what happened in the Neolithic Age. This is what happened without giving any proper explanation or logical rationale. There's definitely a stronger energy that these people were aware of and they could use. And probably this knowledge disappeared when they also vanished from planet Earth.
Of giants have been allegedly unearthed and then secretly taken away.
1997, when more giant bones were reportedly discovered during one of the island's many excavations.
Bones, they were in the records.
But today we probably have about 14 to 1,500 accounts ingoing.
Double row of teeth, 7 foot and taller skeletons reported.
They were actively taken away because they're not matching up with somebody's version of human history. Visited the secret warehouse.
Could several millennia of folklore and mythology be rooted in an incredible reality?
Thank you.
found of giants. And I thought maybe it's in the National Museum where I can find some stories where they found.
Okay, in the museum, there are the exposition of giants of Monteprama, found in Monteprama Cabras. Isn't the giants?
But bones.
Ah, bones, no. Bones, no. The statue. Bones, bones of men, but not giants.
Oh.
Bones, not giant, okay? Giant is that statue, okay? Bones is that individual.
Not...
See, it's natural, okay?
Okay.
So the giants are ordinary statues of stone. However, an intelligent civilization doesn't bury stone statues in an 8-foot-long grave.
E in una di queste torri del villaggio trovarono uno scheletro di un gigante con il piatto ancora nelle gambe e io l'avevo visto, ma non ci facevo importanza. Per me era un essere umano più grande di noi, ma non pensavo ai giganti. E l'avevo visto lì, all'età di 2 anni. Però dopo ne ho visto tanti altri nell'esperienza della vita. Io avevo 10 anni e come di consueto portavo gli agnellini al pascolo di mio nonno dopo la scuola. E io non portai giubbotto, ombrello per ripararmi per la pioggia. Questo temporale pioveva da tutte le parti, era da quella parte la pioggia, arrivava verso qui. Cercai di ripararmi negli alberi ma non faceva nulla perché mi bagnavo lo stesso. Allora ho detto mi metto dietro la tomba perché qui c'era 1 metro di tomba, no? Qui il muretto era alto così. L'ho trovato libero, aperto, e vidi la mummia, entrai dentro subito e guardai la mummia e quando la trovai la testa era qui, la testa, così, qui, e i piedi sotto quella pietra grossa. Presi di nuovo gli anellini di mio nonno, corsi in paese e lo dissi a mio nonno, nonno, ho trovato la mummia del gigante. E mio nonno venne a vedere la mummia e mi disse, guarda, questi sono i nostri parenti. Devi trattarlo bene, devi rispettarlo. Poi lo dissi a scuola il giorno dopo ai miei compagni di scuola, però non interessava a nessuno, perché in quel periodo a qualcuno interessava, ma a pochi, perché in quel periodo ce n'erano tanti di scheletri in tutti i posti buttati, non c'era un interesse. Ce n'erano dappertutto, anche dentro il paese, perciò non interessava a nessuno. Beh. Questo è un dente del gigante, però di un king, bambino.
Wow!
E questo è del babbo, questo qui.
Oh, it's huge!
Whatever where this in his mouth is big.
Questo, vedi? Questo qui è così. E sai cos'è? La spalla, questo. Così. Però questo così arriva così. E il gigante così.
Can I touch it?
Le manca il pezzo, vedi? Questo è un fossilizzato. Fossil. Questa è la vertebra qui, la schiena. Vertebra.
Oh boy, I just touched the bones of a giant. And with that, upon so much more.
German biotechnologist has developed an artificial womb facility for artificially reproducing genetically engineered lab babies. It also introduces an elite package with a menu card for the parents to choose the hair, skin and even eye color of the baby. Carry out genetic corrections in case of disorders. The researchers involved claim that this facility will facilitate the birth of super smart babies.
There is something going on with that ancient world and our origin. Why would they repress important discoveries and lie about the past? Do we really descend from a single pair created by a god under the apple tree, or would we then have actually evolved from the apes? Well, both sounds as bizarre as the fact I just held the tooth of a giant, huh? Now imagine that our history is much different than we are told. And there is a reason for that.
Back in April of 2005, I first came to the central Bosnian town of Visoko to visit the local museum. But what really caught my attention was this. Everybody called it a natural hill because it is covered by soil, bushes, and forest, which was planted back in 1960s and 70s. But I was looking at the geometry. In front of us is one side, to the left another one, to the right another one, in the back the fourth sides. Mm-hmm. So four sides. In front of us one triangular face. When driving around it, I realized we have four triangular faces. We have four corners. We have same slope from bottom to the top. So geometrically speaking, this is a pyramid.
But you're saying that the pyramids are not only based in Egypt.
We are programmed to think pyramids, Egypt and Mexico. Forget that. Pyramids are built on all six continents. After 40 years, I have concluded almost everything they teach us about the ancient history is wrong. The origin of man, civilizations and pyramids. Back in 2005, this was covered by soil. And then we started removing the soil, discovering these blocks. This was the first one that we discovered. It is clearly rectangular in shape. It's 4.5 meters long, 1.5 wide, and 45 centimeters thick. Its mass is 7 tons. Mother Nature does not make blocks with six sides that are perfectly flat and six breaks at 90 degrees. It's made by intelligent hand. Next to this block is another one, and another one. But this is only the first layer of concrete blocks. Below is the second layer, about 40 centimeters, third layer, about 45 centimeters, and the fourth layer. 1, 2, 3, 4. This is a structure. Mother Nature does not construct, but intelligent hands. We took samples from these blocks, sent them to 7 institutes for materials. Politecnico di Torino in Turin, Italy. Then Geopolymer Institute from France. Czech, Slovakia, Bosnia, they all told us this was an artificial concrete. Our concretes, when it comes to the hardness, are in the range from 10 to 60 megapascals. This one here, after we analyzed 50 samples, are in the range from 74 to 155 megapascals.
Wow.
The best quality ever. Between concrete blocks, we have discovered fossilized leaves that got there during the construction phase. The age, 29,200 years plus minus 400 years.
Wow.
And this is radiocarbon date. Calibrated date is usually about 14% more. So the real age of the Bosnian Pyramid of the Sun is 33,600 years, which makes it the oldest pyramid ever. The next element, orientation to the cosmic north. The Great Pyramid of Egypt has an error of 0 degrees and 3 minutes. That's almost perfect. Khafre, the second largest, 0 degrees, 3 minutes. Mycerinos, 0 degrees, 18 minutes. Bent Pyramid in Dakhshur, 0 degrees, 12 minutes. Red Pyramid, 0 degrees, 5 minutes. These are all perfect orientation. But the Bosnian Pyramid of the Sun, 0 degrees, 0 minutes, and 12 seconds. The most precise on the planet. Sacred geometry elements. When we connect the top of the Bosnian Pyramid of the Sun with the top of the Bosnian Pyramid of the Moon, the distance 2,170 meters. From the Moon to the third major pyramid, Dragon Pyramid, 2,170. From Dragon back to the Sun, 2,170 meters. Top of the Love Pyramid, Temple of Mother Earth, tunnels and the river. Triangle within a triangle, again, element of sacred geometry. But not only that, let's use the same center of these triangles. And we are getting the flower of life. This is the cosmic imprint of the life in the universe. The layout of these structures was very precise. It is element of sacred geometry. Why is sacred geometry important? You have elements of sacred geometry, you have movement of the energy. In the case of Egyptian pyramids, we have another element of sacred geometry, which is called golden section or golden ratio, number phi. As a matter of fact, same thing in the case of Bosnian pyramids. If you use tops of the Sun Pyramid and the Moon Pyramid and two more pyramid hills, we are getting the golden ratio. Somebody mentioned star system of Pleiades today. In many oral traditions, from American Indians, Mexican cultures, all the way to India. And usually we know them under the name of Seven Sisters of Pleiades. Although seven sisters or seven stars really are laying on a golden section line. Interestingly enough, five Bosnian pyramids are matching the layout of the Seven Sisters of Pleiades. The Sun, the Moon, the Dragon, the Love, and so on.
Infatuation with the pyramids.
His idea has been dismissed and forgotten over the last century.
In 1905, physics genius Nikola Tesla submitted his U.S. patent, 787412, which was titled The Art of Transmitting Electrical Energy Through the Natural Medium. Tesla realized that the ion sphere was sparkling with electrical energy, which could easily be tapped. Planet Earth was a gigantic electrical generator spinning around two magnetic poles from which limitless energy can be harnessed. But what he discovered was, it was the location of the pyramids that created the power. Tesla's discovery and device disappeared after his mysterious death in 1943. What he was trying to tap into might have just scratched the surface of understanding the power of something much more ancient.
The whole pyramid and the tunnels have huge quantities of quartz crystal. And quartz crystal transforms one form of the energy into another one. Transforms, in this case, electromagnetic fields that are measurable, 28 kilohertz, through the piezoelectrical effect into ultrasound of 28 kilohertz. The frequency of 28 in ultrasound is the levitation frequency. People feel light. So these are huge structures with the oldest and best quality concrete. Imagine that we are able and allowed to clear the forest and the soil above the concrete blocks. Unfortunately, after the first 3 months of digging back in 2006, so April, May, June, in July of 2006, the State Commission for the National Monument claimed that this whole area be a protected area. Why? Because of the small, very modest fortress on the very top of the pyramid, which is 450 meters away from here. So that forgotten fortress they used to stop the digging. Why? Because before that they claimed there was no pyramid. And then once we started digging, we are finding proofs that we were right. So instead of supporting us, helping the project, helping exposing the biggest pyramids in the world, they wanted to do everything to stop us. Sad.
That's sad.
But this is about ego, about lack of knowledge, about jealousy, but also about the pressure coming from some elite circles from UK.
In the tunnels I'm making in the measurements, at least twice per week, this is an alpha lab air ion counter. The negative ions are the filter for our air. They are catching dust, viruses, bacterials. I will choose the polarity, minus, and then the switcher to measure. Showing 7,000. 8,000, it's a very huge and very good concentration. It goes down to 12. We are in the nature. German scientist, he discovered that we need 3 million of negative ions per day that our body cells can work normally.
Oh, really?
And he became also Nobel Prize for it, for the discovering, yeah.
Watch your head, come with me. Ništa, 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 ništa. Sada ću ja. E, dobar dan, kako ste? Vas, stojan, haj.
Neutralize gravitation force somehow.
The idea is to get from here to the pyramid. 2.4 kilometers. Direction south, southeast, east. Entrance to these tunnels, comparing to the top of the pyramid, 280 meters below the top. 476 meters. When we had Russian physicists with the geoelectrical equipment, They measured from the top that 280 meters below there was a network of tunnels and chambers. So the idea is to connect with these tunnels to the tunnels below the pyramid. This is our ultimate archaeological goal. Here in the tunnels we have two civilizations. First one who built this network of tunnels, intersections, chambers, underground lakes, 30,000 years back. And the second one, who closed all the tunnels, filled them up with the filler material. So what we do, we remove the filler material, and then we put the wooden support for the safety reasons, and the lights. So we clean.
Why did they fill it up with material?
$1 million question. Really, why? You know, if you don't want anyone to enter the tunnels, maybe what you can do, you can use explosives and, you basically shut down the entrance. But they filled up every section of the tunnels for kilometers and kilometers. They did very systematic work. And what we see there is actually a tunnel which goes in this direction. And this tunnel has been filled with this non-compact, loose material. So they fill it up all the way to the top. Look at here, half radius ceiling, and somebody closed it up all the way to the top. So, this is the first mystery. Why would somebody go through so much effort to close them? Of course, the first thing that comes to our mind is they didn't want anyone in the future to come closer to the pyramid. But there is probably a little bit more than that. And then we have started finding blocks like this one here. But it's interesting, it's egg-shaped. If I analyze this material, it's a ceramic. If it is ceramic, it means somebody made it, shaped it. To make the ceramic today, we need very high temperature. Pointy part, showing the direction. Over there, there is a tunnel. There is a line all the way on the top. Looks like this is a lid, a cover. Below this block, underground water flow. Water moves in this direction, and the width of the water is from this edge to another one. Uh-huh. So this block is actually an information. For us in 21st century, this is just a piece of rock. Shall we do some measurements here?
Of course.
Yeah.
So, do you remember the concentration outside?
12,000.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's 22.
We're now 80,000, right?
Yeah, so now it's 80. So these are very, very...
But it goes down again till 75.
Okay.
In my report, I would write 76,000.
Okay, yeah.
So I'm always searching the middle ratio.
So negative ions, 70, 80,000. Mm-hmm. It's 50 times higher than outside.
I'm 300 meters away from the underground entrance. No air ducts, and the air quality is 50 times better than outside. And still 20% oxygen. And according to our current knowledge about the laws of nature, pretty impossible. Unless the pyramid above me is doing something we don't yet understand.
De structuur van de piramide, wat doet dat dan?
Nou, wat heel belangrijk is van de piramide is de hoek. He, de graden, zeg maar. Dus het is, het gaat erom dat het zo strak mogelijk is. Dit is 51,5 graden. Mm-hmm. En daarom is het ook belangrijk dat die water pas staat. Want als die een beetje anders staat, zijn die graden ook anders.
Maar wat geeft hier dan energie? Waar zit die energie dan?
Kosmische energie is de energie die om ons heen is. Hè? Waar de planten ook van groeien. Planten groeien niet alleen van voeding. Die hebben ook energie nodig. Zonne-energie, kosmische energie. Die energie hangt om ons heen, overal. En wat die piramide doet, die bundelt die energie. Er zijn wel testen gedaan dat je boven die piramide als het ware een trechter zit, hoe die dat aantrekt.
Is puur alleen de vorm?
De vorm doet dat. Dus net zoals een vergrootglas, hè, zonne-energie bundelt tot een brandpunt, doet hij dat ook. Kosmische energie is een helende energie. Dus in wezen herstelt hij de tuin. Hij komt de energie komt weer vrij uit de grond. Je kunt het ook zien om de piramide heen. Komt soms ook weer planten die jaren niet gezien hebben. Dus oude rassen, oude soorten komen ineens weer op. Het zaad kan schijnbaar heel lang stil liggen. Dat is heel bijzonder, ja.
Heeft het ook op de mens een therapeutische werking?
Ja, het heeft ook de mens ook een therapeutische werking. Het is een hele werking, zeg maar. Hij brengt je terug naar je blauwdruk. Zo je in wezen bedoeld bent. Hè? We lopen in ons leven van alles op, fysiek en emotioneel, waar we niet altijd helemaal oplossen. En die dingen blijven wat hangen en die beginnen met de tijd, beginnen ze te zeuren tot je ergens een klacht krijgt. Maar hij brengt je terug. Dus hij ruimt dingen op, zeg maar.
Ja. De wetenschap die grafieken, statistieken presenteert met 0 en 1. En dat zijn feiten waarop wij, zeg maar, geloven of niet geloven.
Ja.
Zo'n energie van de piramide is natuurlijk heel moeilijk te vangen in die 0 en 1. En hoe vertaal je dat naar mensen?
En 0 en 1 en voelen.
Ja.
Maar we zijn te veel op een 0 en 1. En de rest die zijn we een beetje vergeten. En misschien is er daarom wel zoveel pijn en gedoe in de wereld.
Ja,
dat kan. Hoe je dat vertaald is, ik voelen. Ja, dat zijn we een beetje vergeten de laatste tijd. Open-minded, erin gaan zitten en even je hoofd even uitdoen als het lukt. En dan kun je voelen wat het met je doet. Maar dat zijn we een beetje afgeleerd, zeg maar. Ik denk dat we alles in principe wel weten. Maar dat we dat zijn vergeten, doordat we allemaal zo snel willen en moeten. Er gebeurt heel veel in de wereld. Er zijn vervelende dingen bij, maar daardoor ontstaan er ook heel veel mooie dingen. De mensen worden bewuster en denken van, er is meer. Of ze gaan zoeken omdat ze het niet op hun gemak voelen. En dan, dat is het voordeel van een crisis. Daarna ontstaan vaak hele mooie dingen. Omdat mensen weer op pad gaan. Als alles goed is en het is mooi weer, dan is alles zo het is en het blijft ook zo het is. En als je even pijn hebt, dan denk je, nou, misschien is er een oplossing.
Feierabend. Wat is nou iets waarvan je zelf ook weer overtuigd raakte van de werking van een piramide, van een van de piramides die je hebt geplaatst?
Dat was van een boer. Die heeft heel goed contact met zijn koeien. En een van zijn koeien die was een beetje, hij zei, zeg maar, gek in de kop. Hij snapte er niks van. Ik denk, kan ik de veearts wel bellen? Maar dan komt er een spuitje en kijk, maar weet niet melken. Dus ik denk, ik laat hem even bij de piramide in het kampje. En dan laat die koe bij de piramide in het kampje. En hij doet het hek achter die koe dicht. En die koe loopt loodrecht naar de piramide toe. Gaat erin liggen. Ja, bijzonder. Gaat erin liggen en heeft er een halve dag in gelegen. Volgende dag ging je eten, ging je weer liggen. Ging je weer nog een keer eten. Ging weer in de piramide liggen. Heeft 2 dagen geduurd. Dag 3 stond hij weer voor het hek te roepen. Van jongens, ik ben klaar. En de boer kon gewoon weer melken en deed gewoon weer andere koeien mee.
Echt waar?
Ja. Ja, heel bijzonder. Ja.
Mooi,
man. Ja, ja. Ja, een koe die denkt niet, hè? Die doet gewoon, die voelt, zeg maar. Die heeft op een of andere manier gedacht, ik ga in de piramide liggen. Ja, voor die boer was dat gewoon een bevestiging van wat hij altijd al dacht.
Het pyramids constructed with specific angles and dimensions have mysterious and miraculous effects on the material kept inside
them.
Some
of the findings of such studies include rapid growth of plants, faster healing of bruises and burns, longer preservation of milk, increased vitalization and better relaxation in human subjects.
There are three options. I believe, I don't, or simply tried myself. So I built a pyramid. And turned it into a garden greenhouse. With a tunnel, of course. So, let spring arrive. And time will tell.
Archaeologists, geologists, historians, they cannot explain what is the purpose of pyramids. Why? Because they don't have engineering minds. They don't understand the energies. But physicists, they do. Electrical engineers, sound engineers, telecommunication engineers, or even medical doctors, because they measure. One day we sent 7 different instruments to measure electromagnetism, electrical field, magnetic field, ultrasound, infrasound, level of organ energy, and the temperature. The most interesting results were in the area of the electrical field.
So, Goran, you did the measurements of the electrical energy beam on top of the Bosnian pyramids, right?
That was 2011 when I came in Visoko and do my measurings
and find a very, very strong electric field without magnetic component on the top of the pyramid
of 28 kilohertz.
But our regular energy system is based on electromagnetic energy, right? So could you first of all define electromagnetic energy compared to the energy measured at the Bosnian pyramids?
We have two waves, electric and magnetic waves, and propagate in a third direction. That's a classical electromagnetic wave which has both electric and magnetic fields. But if I find only vibrations of electric field without magnetic component, or vice versa, I can speak about scalar waves. When I find the Tesla verse where he said that he does not use Hertzian waves, that mean electromagnetic waves which we use for communication, for radio, TV, mobile, etc., etc. So that was very interesting for me because main frequency of his most famous object which he made is Wardenclyffe Tower, and the operational frequency of his world station was exactly 28 kilohertz. So when we calculate and compare everything of that, what we got was one very interesting form of distribution of energy strength, of voltage amplitude in different points. There we can be absolutely sure that the ether exists.
A beam of energy from the tip of the pyramid to the sky. It may be so, but what purpose did it serve?
Our conclusion, the first purpose of the pyramid energy is the communication device.
A communication to whom?
Of course, it opens up more questions.
Yeah.
If our planet is point A, it has to be point B, and point C, and point D. We measured direction of this energy beam. In the morning, it's moved a little bit to the east, where the sun rises on the east. At the noontime, south. In the afternoon, southwest. In the evening, west. Does it mean that our planet communicates with our sun? And through the sun, as the cosmic gate through to other solar systems and other star constellations and other galaxies, it's possible.
Mm.
And then the movement of the information is always two ways. The pyramid acts as the transmitter. It emits the energy. But at the same time, the pyramid is an antenna. It receives the energy. Is it possible that we have a phenomenon called cosmic internet? Maybe. What do we know? This is one of the blocks that we discovered back in 2006. It was completely covered by pebbles and rocks. Once we removed that, we discovered those carvings. Now look at this one here.
Oh, yeah.
When we compare those symbols with the runic symbols, so we have some symbols that perfectly match runic symbols. Total of 8 of them. We have sent those 8 symbols to 2 professors in the US asking for decipherment. And this is how the message goes. The gate has been closed. We are at the standstill. We will have to defend ourselves and conquer until the cosmic gate is open again.
Wow, that's a message.
Who is writing the history here, and how true is it? Or is it sold to us with a purpose? Wow. Why are facts and observations dogmatically dismissed as mythological and unscientifically? Are we really that smart? Or is modern man blindly wrapping himself into an unnatural, obedient and brain-dead game? Could that be the purpose? The reason why these narratives are anxiously kept silent. Imagine, we have healing water, free energy, and a balanced mind. Then, yeah. Who then has to buy all those drugs, huh? What is secret geometry?
Secret geometry is a terminology invented in the 19th century when some people began to try to analyze temples. And they found, for example, relation with the circle, of course, with the square, with the pentagon. They tried to understand what was going on with the geometry of these cathedrals, of the pyramids, of these Hindu temples. And so they called that sacred geometry because it was related to sacred places. The function of the geometry, it's a drawing that regulates the shape of the building. It regulates not only the shape, but it regulates the energy of the place. Okay? So this is a geometry that makes that the place is connected with some rhythms that make the place better for living and healthier.
So living for whom? For man and nature, or only?
For both.
For both.
They were aware that they needed energy to power the places. All the temples are built on crossings of water veins that are chosen. Most of the places they choose were chosen before by the ancient people, the people of Neolithic, the people of the dolmens, the people of the menhirs. I should say the people of the menhirs, the people of the dolmens, because it seems the dolmens people invade the menhir people. All the land was recognized by these people. They was surveyed by these people. Mm-hmm. They knew where the spots were, etc., etc. They knew very well the land, and they built dolmens, they built menhirs, etc., places with some energy. Okay, when the Romans, for example, began to build, or the Greeks, etc., they took these places, the best places, to build their temples. The earth is always vibrating. You have, for example, earth tides that makes that the earth vibrates, goes up 30 centimeters and down 30 centimeters in a day. Okay, and so that makes that everything that is on Earth is vibrating. It's the menhir of Pergat.
this point here is a violet point. You feel the energy going up. I can't. Here it is. Here. You're going to feel that the energy goes up like that. This is a water that goes like that, runs like that.
Here's water going underneath.
Yeah.
Ah.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that makes this an energetic.
Yes. Yes. It's a, it's a crossing of water in the middle. Okay. And so when you have the crossing of water, you have a vortex of energy. Okay. This vortex of energy, there is a difference of potential, electrical, electromagnetic difference of potential, okay? That makes that the vortex, like the energy, the electricity goes up and down like that, okay? And so this stone is a granite. It's like with mica and quartz, etc., feldspath, for example, you have a kind of little batteries inside. And so they charge with electricity of the water.
It's like a vortex.
Okay, and makes a vortex, okay? And when it's too charged, it expels the energy up. And it's stabilizing the place. Okay, the energy of the place, so all the rings are expanding all the time, because you remember the earth is doing this and this and this and this, okay? And the energy of the water, so it's working like an antenna, so it's making its rings, emitting its stuff, okay, and healing the place.
I don't really feel the energy, but somehow it's a magical place where mostly my mind rides an energetic wave to other perspectives. Because there is more, much more. This stone was put here for a reason, with a function, and it was lifted here with incredible power.
The one thing we need to embrace is that ancient civilizations had a body of knowledge and information that we've long lost. When you start studying the origins of humankind and ancient human history and ancient civilizations, it doesn't take long before you realize that something doesn't quite fit. And then we start finding the ancient ruins of Southern Africa. He organized a helicopter flip. We flew around looking at these Stone Circle ruins. It's only when I saw it from the air and I saw the density of the ruins, how interconnected it is, that it's not just stone circles lying around randomly, that it's stone circles that are connected to each other by these channels that look like pathways, and then mountaintops that are covered in these terraces that are interlaced with stone circles and channels linking the stone circles together. Before I realized, I counted more than 10 million of these stone circle roots. So we do know that the stone circles generate energy. They are frequency generating devices. And this is why each stone circle is a certain shape. No two stone circles are the same. Each one is completely unique. And they're all connected together because each stone circle generates a huge amount of sound frequencies, magnetic fields, and electromagnetic fields. So the sound frequencies come out of the ground, and the shape of the stone circle is determined by the sound frequency that comes out of the ground. It's called cymatics, the cymatic pattern. Mm-hmm.
That is eigenlijk een apparaatje dat een trilling creëert op de plaat, zeg maar.
Ah ja, dus we creëren eigenlijk het aardoppervlak, maar dan in het heel erg mini.
Ja, ja, zo met het zand erop en het zout. Alright, 916 hertz, daar gaan we.
Wow.
Is 1224 hertz. 1228 hertz. Daar gaan ze weer.
Cool.
En 916.
Wow.
So we know that the stone circles generate frequency. We've measured it. We've measured very, very high frequencies coming out of the stone walls. And especially some of the stone circles that are shaped like flowers. We call the flower-shaped stone circles. Those are just giant magnetrons. Magnetrons that are used in electrical devices like microwaves, little tiny magnetron like this that's in every microwave that generates all that power. They are little flower-shaped devices, magnetrons that create laser beams and phaser beams and all that kind of stuff in modern technology. So these flower-shaped stone circles are actually just giant magnetrons. And so this entire grid and connection are connected, you know, millions of stone circles all connected to each other. It's just a huge energy-generating machine. And that's when I realized, oh my God, we're dealing with an unknown civilization.
Could the use of magnets, sacred geometry, or water that gathers etheric energy be the method used by a previous lost civilization? Combine this with highly advanced ancient technology, which may have been lost with a previous generation unknown to us, and we may find some answers in the buildings right in front of us. Is achieved using geometry, water, or magnetism. Designed intelligent buildings that worked in conjunction with the vibrations of one's consciousness, Mother Nature, and possibly sound itself, using sacred engineering and architecture and possessing the knowledge of metaphysical geometry and sacred mathematics. Was it used to tap into free energy in the ether?
It's all based on geometry, resonance frequencies. Everything vibrates. If we had an electric razor, we plugged it in, turned it on, set it on this table, it's going to move around, isn't it? Everything that?
Yeah.
That's the beginning of the concept, because it's vibrating. Everything vibrates at a frequency, and if you know that frequency, you can control things.
Klinkt goed, ja.
Ja.
Jezus. Ik heb maar zo geguckt, zo'n orgel. Wie alt en kompliziert dat gebouwd is, dat baut mir niet zum Spaß.
Nein, sicherlich niet zum Spaß.
Sollte man sagen, da muss das Orgel eigenlijk nog een tiefere Bedeutung hebben.
Ja, ja, natürlich. Ja, ja, klar. Also, die Orgel hat natürlich eine ganz, ganz lange Geschichte. Und das geht ja zurück bis ins alte Griechenland. Aber es hat sich sehr oft geändert. Ne? Also im alten Rom, da gab es schon Orgeln, die waren im Zirkus eingesetzt. Als zum Beispiel die Christen den Löwen vorgeworfen wurden, spielte dabei eine Orgel. Insofern ist es umso ironischer, eine Ironie der Geschichte, dass ausgerechnet die Orgel dann später zu dem christlichen Instrument in der westlichen Kultur wurde eigentlich. Hat wahrscheinlich auch etwas damit zu tun, die Orgel kann das machen. Und da sitzen wir jetzt und das läuft immer weiter. Und dieser ewige Atem, nicht? Das, kein anderes Instrument kann das. Also heute digitale Instrumente, ja. Aber alte Instrumente konnten das nicht. Und das ist so ein bisschen der Atem des Unendlichen, ne? Der da so ein bisschen drinsteckt.
Kann man sagen, dass das Orgel, die Frequenz der Orgel, eigentlich auch resoniert mit den Menschen, die in die Kirche waren? War das irgendwie so eine wichtige Abstimmung?
Ja, auf jeden Fall. Also, was wir natürlich sehen bei einer Orgel, diese Größe vor allem, es gibt noch größere Orgeln, aber das ist schon eine sehr große Orgel. Wir haben hier natürlich Töne, das ist jetzt der tiefste Ton hier, den hört man nicht nur, den spürt man auch. Ja, also das heißt, dieses Fundament, dieses Klangfundament, das hier abgedeckt wird, ist eigentlich größer als das eines Orchesters, zumindest der damaligen Zeit. Also ein Computer kann ja hergehen und Sinuskurven machen und sich errechnen dies und jenes und dann kriegst du einen digitalen Klang. Aber dieser digitale Klang resoniert in gewisser Weise nicht, weil er eben nicht echt ist. Der kommt schon aus einem Lautsprecher heraus, währenddessen wir hier ja tatsächlich reale Luft haben, die durch Bleipfeifen hindurchgeht und Schwingungen und Vibrationen erzeugt, die sich dann durch den ganzen Raum fortsetzen. Also ich glaube, man kann bei so etwas, das ist ja auch kein Zufall, wenn die Leute in eine Kirche kommen und sie reden und sie hebt die Stimme und man hört dann auf einmal das Echo und alles das ist ja alles ein Beitrag dazu. Eigentlich, man muss so ein bisschen verstehen, die ganze Kirche ist eigentlich ein großer Resonanzraum. Wir sitzen hier in einem Resonanzkasten und nehmen auch selber daran teil, aber wir sind mitten darin.
The cathedrals are incredibly sophisticated energy harvesting and energy generating devices. Just modern versions of the temples in Egypt and the temples in ancient civilizations. It's right there for everyone to see. If you understand sound, frequency, electronics, resonance, it's very obvious what you're looking at. The stone circles are generating energy from the frequency of the earth, and cathedrals and churches today generate energy from the people being inside the church. You put a whole bunch of people inside a church or a cathedral, they make a lot of noise, they sing, they dance, they clap, and that sound goes up into the dome, it amplifies it, puts it into the tower, which is a cone. That cone speeds up the sound, it creates a phaser beam, and that phaser beam gets shot out of the top of the tower. And then some of the tops of the towers have little antennas with little balls on them, which suggest to us that they're actually controlling the frequency or to create a specific wave or a wavelength or a frequency of the sound coming out of that church that's created by the people in that cathedral or the church. This is just, it's very simple acoustics and harmonics. If you understand it, it's a no-brainer.
Perhaps everything is not what it may seem. So that we no longer have access to technological buildings and structures that could help expand our consciousness and harness the free energy of the earth.
Cathedrals as ancient energy harvesting labs by frequencies, morally hidden by the holiest on earth. It almost looked like the perfect politics. However, the story is becoming a little complex and almost too big to comprehend. But all big things can be explored in a very small. Whether the pyramid works or not, the crops here are not growing, but have exploded into giants in 20 days.
Matt, you proclaimed we could harvest the energy around us for the benefit of the crops with copper. So what exactly are we harvesting in the atmosphere?
That beautiful energy that's all around us, the ether, the chi, the prana, the life force energy, orgone, whichever word you would like to call it, there's all types of energy around us. And this was shown back in the 1900s too in Germany, when they used to send balloons up into the air to gather atmospheric energy. They would hang a little wire down, you know, from the balloon, and they would collect that atmospheric energy. The higher you go up, the more energy that you can see. So when you're placing these antennas into your garden, such as a piece of wood and a piece of copper, you're creating coils around that piece of wood, and that those coils are harvesting or harnessing the energy that's all around us, Mother Earth's energy. Mother Earth sends out vibrations every single second, right? And what we're doing is we're picking up on those vibrations so that we can elevate our gardens, our plant life, our pollinators, our bees, our birds, and the energy that's all around us. One of the biggest things that I've noticed since people started doing electroculture is they start to have all different types of pollinators come around, all different types of birds, all different types of bees.
Why are we humans need to reconnect the garden with these frequencies? Why nature is not achieving this organically?
What's happening is we're losing a lot of that energy because of all of these towers, the cell phone towers, all of this man-made frequency, right? And so what we're trying to do is we're trying to elevate our gardens and bring back the Earth's frequency and help increase that. Because it's interesting when you look at technology, like the U.S. Navy, right? They use, for example, the Schumann resonance of 7.83 hertz to communicate all across the world, right? So what we're doing is with electroculture is we're tapping into that same Schumann resonance, which is going all around the world, and we're using it to help elevate our garden. A lot of this was lost with the resets of World War I and World War II. You know, a lot of information was lost related to these types of ways because it made us more dependent on the chemical farming instead of using the energy from the earth.
Having enough food for the almost 8 billion people in the world is quite a challenge already. Is it realistic to adequately meet world food demand with electroculture?
1940s, Victor Schauberger and all of his work, right? He presented all of this to the Bulgarian government at the time, right? He presented copper tools, he presented copper plows, he presented all types of things derived from copper. He even showed how you can vortex water to structure it, you know, using copper. He showed all of this, and this was all shown. And he determined that when you use copper in the soil, you'd start yielding 2 to 3 times more food. You know, you wouldn't need as much water, right? So your plants don't need as much water. They'll start growing faster. And he noticed like potatoes were 2-3 times the size. He noticed tomatoes were 2-3 times the size. All these different foods were 2-3 times the size. You know, so when it comes to abundance, if we just tap into the energy, we could have abundance. But if we use all these chemicals, which are blocking up the energy and blocking up the earth and really destroying the earth, right? And destroying our health, right? Because that's what these chemicals are doing. They're destroying our health too. We eat them, and then we're poisoned and have health issues as well. So we can't have abundance if we're poisoning ourselves. You know, it doesn't make any sense, and the land and the insects and all of those things. But Victor Schauberger presented all of this, and during the 1940s, the Bulgarian government actually shot it down because the person in charge at that time was basically getting a kickback from the fertilizer companies. And what they did was they put out a broadcast on the news and on the radio saying that if you use copper tools instead of iron, because iron leads to rust and decay, you would yield too much food and not make enough money. And the farmers at that time were, you know, like, I don't want to be a part of that. So when it comes to abundance, 1940s, right, just before World War II, we saw all of the abundance that was there. And he was showing it. He was showing it with so many different people. He would go and give them gardening tools and go, try this out, you'll see what happens. And he recorded so much abundance, but it was all pretty much moved away. And then, like I said, as we became more on the chemical farming and moving more towards that, we moved away from that energetic principle. But a lot of this information was removed and taken away. And as that information was taken away, and the books were also removed as well, right, relating to these topics, as all of that was removed, we lost this idea for abundance, and we started to connect to basically spraying chemicals all over our plants. And as we became that way, we also became dependent on the chemical companies. And now those same chemical companies are gene altering the plants so that they can own the patents to the seeds, so that they can keep making money off of something that is completely free, which is nature. If people are using this beautiful energy, they could have a ton of food and then they could share it with their friends and family. Right now, I have a lot of people who message me and tell me, I'm giving my food out to X, Y, and Z because I have so much, they have to come over and take it. And that's what I'm all about, the abundance and everybody having prosperity with their food. An exchange and trade between each other, and then we get rid of the whole control on the money system.
Hey, Alex.
Hey, Brian, how you doing?
Yeah, good, man. Good.
What are you up to today?
I had a brief chat with, he's a guy working with copper in the garden. Copper seems to resonate quite good with the frequency in the atmosphere.
Yeah.
And it's bringing the frequencies into the soil. In 1940, it was banned.
Yeah.
This technique. And that's for me a good reason to try it.
But I love it. I love at the moment that we're basically trying everything that's forbidden.
Yeah.
Because it's like they're keeping all the simple things that we can all do that are free, that'll keep us from thriving properly again. And if this works, I mean, what does it mean for all the other simple things out there? I mean, in certain respects, nature provides everything for free.
That's it, yeah.
And this is really bad for business if this works, Marianne, you know. Fertilizer companies are gonna be like knocking down your door saying, Marianne, you're a fraud.
That doesn't bother me, you know. When it's working, it's working.
And
they can call me a pig. Doesn't matter. The pressure from outside is awakening something in people to do just those things who are being kept under the surface, right?
Yeah. Well, and I mean, they want to become independent again. I mean, we've all become so dependent from the electricity to your credit card to, you know, where do you get your fuel? Where do you get your food? And if we start doing this stuff, suddenly everyone is a free individual again, can provide their own food, their own shelter, their own. And then they've got time to be happy. And I do feel that they're getting scared of happy people. Because people are hugging, having dinner together, growing their own food, getting their hands dirty and creating life rather than what seems to be the trend is destroying, you know, destroy the individual, destroy the identity, destroy the gender, destroy the children, destroy the nature. And it can be something as simple as copper wire wrapped around a stick, which wakes a person up to the power that they have to create beauty and life.
Call it naive, contrarian, or even stupid. But the quieter the story, the more it awakens something in me to do just that. And as far as the abundance of food is concerned, I'm pretty well on my way. I honestly don't know what a kohlrabi should normally look like, but in the supermarket, they are on a skimpy side.
Hmm.
Licht, keine Elektroheizung, keine Züge, kein Telefon und kein Internet. Vorbereitung auf den Krisenfall. Die Französen.
Investigators that several agencies believe something landed or crashed. Whether it was non-humans or not, it certainly scared the people living on this property.
When a Las Vegas Metro police officer's body cam catches this, something flashing low in the sky.
911 emergency.
Minutes later,
there's an 8-foot person beside it, and another one inside, and it has big eyes and looking at us.
Okay, where is this on your property?
In my backyard. I swear to God, this is not a joke. This is actually really terrifying.
So there's two people or two subjects that are in your backyard?
Correct, and they're very large.
I'm a bit scared to ask the question, but those stone circles you discovered, who built them?
At this stage, everything points to the entities referred to as the Anunna gods, or the Anunna, or the Anunnaki in the Sumerian texts, and the primary deity there called Enki, who was the supreme commander of the Anunnaki here on Earth. And their main objective was to mine gold. And literally, they came to Earth from wherever they came from. There are all kinds of arguments as to where they came from.
But these Anunnakis, were they human?
No, the Anunnaki were not human. No, the Anunnaki were not human. So the Anunnaki are literally the central principal characters of the Sumerian texts. Millions of clay tablets discovered in the Middle East, the Near East, in Mal Mesopotamia area. And hundreds of thousands have been translated. And those translations are often kept very secret.
Kept secret by whom?
It's held the money to fund that research, to do the translations. There are many stories and books written about that, how some of the translators of the early Sumerian texts were compartmented. They were brought together to translate them. Then they realized they were translating stuff that was, otherworldly. It was like mind-blowing advanced technology of these beings that weren't human. And they were translating all these clay tablets, and then suddenly they realized, oh my goodness, this is a problem for us. So they started to separate the translators, that the translators weren't allowed to talk to each other. And you just see the control creep in when they realize that the translations are very important information that cannot be shared with humanity, that they wanted to keep for themselves. But a lot of it is leaked out.
Where did the Sumerians get their information from?
The Sumerians tell us in the clay tablets that they got their information from the civilizations and the people and that were in a time before time. So not just a few thousand years ago, many, many thousands of years ago. A time before time.
Are seven tablets of cuneiform writing that were date back over 7,000 years, and they're located at the British Museum. These cuneiform tablets actually talk about the creation of our solar system as we know it right now, including how Earth was created and how we acquired our moon. But when you really break it down and understand it, it's the epic of the creation of our solar system itself. In fact, the Bible copied a lot of the content from the Enumerlish into Genesis.
The written accounts etched into stone suggest the Anunnaki were giant beings standing 8 feet tall who came to Earth in search of gold for their home planet. When the Sumerians, standing 8 feet tall, who came to Earth in search of gold for their home planet. When the Sumerian gods, the Anunnaki, realized the toll it was taking to mine the gold themselves,
they started to mine gold. And after a few thousand years of mining gold, they realized that, hey, we don't want to do all the hard labor. Let's clone a slave to work for us. And that's where humanity comes in. So they literally mixed a bunch of DNA, the way that we're messing around with it today, trying to create transhumans and transhumanism.
Dr. Paniotis Zavos implants 11 of the embryos in 4 women in the hope of producing the first cloned human being.
Scientists create synthetic human embryos.
Basically clone a human child.
Enables stem cells to be reprogrammed.
Now the mother will no longer have to carry the kid for 9 months. It can be raised in a bag thanks to new technology.
Some people will think this is Frankenstein science. It's not like that, but it has the potential to be, and certainly we need to regulate it.
If we can clone humans today, wouldn't it be arrogant to think that highly intelligent societies before us, about which we know so little, could not do so? At least something created us, which is a crazy idea at all. And that something had a reason for creating us. And they're doing it again.
Well, they cloned a new species called the Adamu. He had to be smart enough to understand instructions and have a thing called fear, or the appreciation of consequence. That if you don't do what we tell you, you will be punished and it'll hurt you. It was serious genetic manipulation. And it took them a long time to get that balance right. They seem to have created hundreds, if not thousands, of different species in that process. It wasn't neither male or female, but it was very masculine, without the ability to be able to procreate. They would be born adults. And then they come out of these cloning chambers, and then they spend a few months learning how to walk, how to instruct. They teach them everything, and they told, and from birth, they are programmed to be slaves, to handle tools, to do this, and to understand if you don't do this, you're gonna get punished and it's gonna hurt you. And that's it, they're born into slavery and they die slaves. And that's pretty much what's happening to humanity today. You know, think about us. We are born, we come into this world, we didn't sign a contract.
And if you disagree about climate change or vaccination or the voice, you'll be vilified and demonized and cancelled.
You'll be punished and it'll hurt you.
Except that you're a citizen and a resident of...
Hanged or whatever, but ultimately you still remain a slave. So after several thousand years of cloning these first creatures as the slaves in the gold mines, it became too difficult to keep cloning them. And it's that moment that we get the Adam and Eve story in the Bible that comes in. That's when they took the essence from Adam. The essence from Adam was his DNA. And they took that DNA and they manipulated that DNA to create the X chromosome and the Y chromosome. And that's why suddenly we see the two new sexes being created. Then they created Eve from Adam's DNA. They created a new chromosome from him, so he suddenly could procreate. Adamu could suddenly procreate, and suddenly there was this female that could be his partner. That's why they put them into a place, into a garden or something that we call the Garden of Eden. It was an observational space to see what happens, because this is a new experiment. Will the female eat the male after they copulate, like certain species do? They didn't know. Will she beat him or will he beat her? Will they kill each other? How are they going to get on? But it was a place of observation where they put Adam and Eve together to see if they would get on, if they could shag each other and procreate offspring. And it worked. And here we are, you know, several thousand years later, and we still have no idea who we are, where we come from, and why we're here. And we're still slaves to the system and to those who control the system.
Hey Rob, zijn we eigenlijk nog steeds slaven of vind je hier in het Europees Parlement nog een enige vorm van menselijkheid?
Ja, er zit wel menselijkheid in, maar ik moet wel zeggen, veel politici die raken wel gevangen in het systeem. En het systeem, daarmee wil ik zeggen, mensen komen hier, verdienen toch een aardig inkomen. Mm. Mensen willen daar wel in blijven. Mm. En dan begint het, want het mandaat duurt hier 5 jaar. En uiteindelijk wil je toch wel in die mooie woning blijven wonen.
Ja.
Dan ga je aansluiten in het groepsdenken, want uiteindelijk moet je daarin mee. Ja, dan ga je je best doen om hier te blijven. Waardoor zeg maar dat je zonder last en ruggespraak, dat valt weg, dat verwatert. Mm. Veel politici maken een carrière van hun, van de politiek. En dat is gewoon zonde, want uiteindelijk moet de intentie zijn om de burgers te dienen. Ja, en dan ben je dan een slaaf van het systeem, dat is misschien een groot woord. Maar je zit wel gevangen in het systeem.
Maar als er zoveel lagen gevangen zijn in dat systeem, in hoeverre kun je dan nog spreken van een democratie?
Ja, ik vind dat de democratie echt aan het verschralen is. En nu komt er een pandemiewet aan. Hè? De WHO, de World Health Organization, dat is het idee dat die dadelijk veel macht krijgen op het moment dat er een nieuwe pandemie uitbreekt.
COVID-19 can be characterized as a pandemic.
And the WHO pandemic tree.
An unelected international body with no accountability.
Their owners are corporate donors.
Ordering border closures on countries, travel restrictions, tracing of contacts, refusal of entry, forced quarantining, medical examinations, including requirements for proof of vaccination, and even the forced medication of individuals.
But you don't have a choice. People act like you have a choice.
WHO will also decide what is science and what is disinformation.
Stigmatize dissent as a mental health condition.
And then control what you can say.
You have to force behaviors, and at BlackRock we are forcing behaviors. Yeah!
Er dus niet aan denken dat zo'n organisatie alles te vertellen krijgt over bijvoorbeeld een situatie dat we een pandemie hebben in Nederland en dat zij dan gaan beslissen wat er wel en niet moet gebeuren. Dat vind ik wel een van de voorbeelden dat we steeds meer van onze democratische waarden uit handen geven en dat we uiteindelijk een moment bereiken dat je zegt ja, het is geen echte democratie meer.
I can talk myself into a hopeful story, but I always come down with the simple observation that we are still the slaves. Whether you're a politician, banker, pharmacist, farmer, or a normal citizen, we all know the solution, do we? But we're stuck dead in a system of interests and concerns ruled by a certain elites who created the system. And whoever they are smart enough to let us believe in myths and turn myths into reality.
Capricci really easy.
Die Masse sind die Armen, ne? Im Mittelalter, ne? Haben wir ja, war der Papst, brauchte seinen Petersdom, brauchte viel Geld, ne? Hat seine Leute überall hingeschickt, haben dann geklingelt, ne? Und dann haben die verkündet, wenn das Geld im Kasten klingt, die Seele aus dem Fegefeuer in den Himmel springt. Heißt erst bezahlen. Wenn nicht bezahlt wird.
Climate change can tear us apart.
Dann bist du für immer im Fegefeuer, ne? Angst haben. Oh Gott, ich will bezahlen, ne? Es ist nichts anderes wollte, als immer gewesen. Den Menschen wird Angst gemacht, ne? Ohne Angst der Massen, keine Bewegung der Massen, ne? Warum ist es gut für die Leute, an etwas zu glauben? Jeder Mensch kommt irgendwo mal auf Deutsch gesagt in die Scheiße, ne? Und dann geht es ihm ganz dreckig. Und wer oder was kann ihm helfen in der Zeit? Nichts anderes, nur noch der Glaube. Lieber Gott, hilf mir. Lieber Mohammed, hilf mir. Lieber Indianerhäuptling, hilf mir. Ne? Alle wollen Hilfe haben, sie glauben also. Ne? Wenn das Glauben, der Glaube aber im Menschen schon implantiert ist, damit er sich unter Umständen in Notzeiten an irgendetwas klammern kann, dann muss es auch möglich sein, in diesen Glauben zu missbrauchen. Ne?
But for heaven's sake, don't kill this moment.
Joe Biden promised to help avoid planet cooking, climate changing, fossil fuel suicide.
We should speed things up in the transition to renewable energy.
Und dies ist nichts weiter als das von der hierarchischen Struktur auf der Erde, die das erkannt haben oder dieses Wissen haben. Ne? Es muss möglich sein, diese Geschichte zu verkaufen. Ne?
Slow down climate change.
Ein gigantisches Geschäft daraus zu machen.
Denn aktuell regnet es zum Beispiel ganz im Süden Deutschlands. Hier zieht der Regen von West nach Ost. Wird auf jeden Fall ein paar Flocken geben. Bevor ich damit weitermache, ein kurzer Einschub. Es gibt einen neuen Rekord beim Kohlendioxidgehalt der Atmosphäre.
Wir brauchen nur noch die Zahler dafür. Nicht die Krankheit ist bekannt, die Klimakatastrophe, ne? Und das nicht der Bacillus ist auch bekannt. CO2.
Einer dramatischen Krise.
Die Medikamente, die dagegen sind, sind klar. Energie verteuern. Irre teuer machen, ne?
High gas prices are driving electricity prices.
Und unten muss es bezahlt werden.
Do you see the patterns? It's a mind game. They are masters in divide and conquer and ruling the servants by fear and deception. The spiritual state of the world is in confusion and chaos because we simply no longer understand who we are and where we once were. We've lost our genetic information in the ravages of time. An oak without roots will never be able to develop into a sturdy tree. But either way, we as humans will have to find a way to liberation. And we may find a solution closer to nature than we ever could imagine.
And I love a boy in here.
Eine Greenbox ist so eine kleine Box mit Schublade, in die man Samen einbringen kann und die Samen ankeimen lassen kann da drin, wenn die in Feuchtigkeit sind. Das Resultat ist, dass die Genexpression innerhalb der Samen sich ändert.
Also DNA?
Die Information, die in der Genetik vorhanden ist, die ja im Samen integriert ist oder da drin sich befindet, die wird anders aufgrund von diesem Umweltfaktor, dem statischen Elektrofeld, verändert.
Wird dann eigentlich die natürliche Umwelt auch simuliert in der Box?
Genau. Es ist so, dass wir grundsätzlich schon ein solches statisches Elektrofeld auf der Erde haben, zwischen Ionosphäre, was eine Schicht ist in der Atmosphäre, und der Erdoberfläche. Wobei die Ionosphäre der positive Pol ist, elektrisch gesehen, und die Erdoberfläche der negative Pol.
Und da dazwischen haben wir die Luft, die Atmosphäre, die eigentlich den Ausgleich abisoliert. Daraus resultiert dann, dass auch hier ein Spannungsgefälle zwischen Ionosphäre und Erdoberfläche vorhanden ist, was im Mittel etwa 130 Volt pro Meter groß ist. In diesem Umfeld wachsen wir auf, kommen wir zur Welt und werden groß und werden erwachsen und sterben auch wieder etc. und geben unsere Gene auch weiter, also von Vater, Mutter zu Kind etc. immer in dieser Umgebung. Dass sich diese Umgebung ändert, ist aber eben auch gegeben. Das heißt, die Umgebung des statischen Elektrofeldes. Wenn wir uns vorstellen, dass wir vorindustrialisierte Zeit haben, in der weniger Schadstoffe, sage ich jetzt mal, in die Atmosphäre abgegeben wurden, wie heute oder nach der Industrialisierung, dann können wir uns vorstellen, dass damals das statische Elektrofeld auch höher war. Wenn wir das ansehen, dann muss sich ja das ganze die biologische Umgebung dem auch anpassen. Also das sind ja Faktoren, die einzelnen Organismen umgeben und in denen sie aufwachsen und sich durchsetzen müssen, überleben wollen und sich dann auch eben anpassen, evolutiv Änderungen vornehmen an ihrer Genetik, je nachdem auch, um das zu adaptieren. Aber ohne das wieder auszulöschen, was schon war und was sie schon erlebt hatten. Das heißt mit anderen Worten, wenn vor Industrialisierung eine Pflanze gewachsen ist mit einem stärkeren elektrischen Feld, dann war dieser Zustand genetisch auch überwunden oder überlebt worden und genetisch abgelegt, wie man darauf reagiert. Und jetzt auch nachträglich, wenn die Pflanze heute immer noch lebt und nicht ausgestorben ist, wegen der Abnahme jetzt sagen wir, des statischen E-Feldes, ist auch das genetisch abgelegt, wieder im Gencode. Wenn ich ihm jetzt im Prinzip einen Zustand anbiete, im Labor oder einfach technisch durch das, dass ich so eine Box nehme, was, sagen wir, 250 Jahre zurückliegt, würde er sich daran erinnern, weil das hat er genetisch auch schon mal durchlebt und kann darauf wieder reagieren und reagiert dann so, wie er damals darauf reagiert hatte und was ihm ja geholfen hat, zu überleben.
Das heißt eigentlich, dass der DNA immer da ist und bleibt, nicht kaputt gehen kann und es kann wieder reaktiviert werden.
Ja, also es gibt auf alle Fälle Informationen innerhalb des genetischen Codes, der entstanden ist und jetzt nicht mehr gebraucht wird, das heißt stillgelegt war und jetzt im Prinzip wieder reaktiviert werden kann. Das ist richtig, genau. Und, aber die Antwort, falls so ein Zustand wieder entsteht, bei der genau diese Reaktion benötigt wird, die genetisch abgelegt wird, wird die reaktiviert oder kann reaktiviert werden und deshalb die Überlebenschance erhöht werden. Ein Organismus hat ein Erinnerungsvermögen dadurch, dass es eine DNA hat, weil es eben so und so viel genetische Informationen hat, die evolutiv abgelegt wurden, nicht gelöscht, sondern stillgelegt und immer noch vorhanden ist. Auch wir brauchen nicht mehr wie 5, glaube ich, bis 7% der DNA, um unseren Organismus zu exprimieren und die ganzen Lebensvorgänge zu steuern. Mhm. 95% sind stillgelegt, also es ist relativ viel. Und daraus resultiert, dass man da sehr viel Information hat, die abgerufen werden kann, in Situationen, die schon einmal durchlebt und überlebt worden sind. Also genetisch dazu führten, dass es uns noch gibt. Und das, was wir eben gefunden haben, das ist, dass wir bei Weizen zum Beispiel aus einem Samen wieder eine alte Buschform bekommen. Also dass da dann 36 Ähren entstehen aus einem Samen, das dem ursprünglichen unkultivierten Weizen entspricht. Der wird etwa 20 cm groß und hat Ähren, die sind sehr klein, aber das ist ein Busch. Und diese genetische Form wurde ja später ausgezüchtet und zu unserem Weizen heute gebracht. Und dieser Weizen ist ein gezüchteter Weizen, der durch selektive Auszucht eigentlich entstanden ist über Jahrtausende. Der hat aber dabei auch seine Buschform verloren. Er wurde höher, die Stängel wurden höher, die Ähren wurden größer, aber die Menge an einzelnen Stängeln ist über diese Selektion verloren gegangen. Nur können wir jetzt durch das statische E-Feld wieder eine Erinnerung hervorrufen, die an diesen Busch erinnert.
Und man braucht weniger Fläche.
Und im Prinzip, ja, brauchen wir im Grunde genommen weniger Samen pro Hektar, um den gleichen Ertrag zu erhalten. Gleichzeitig benötigen wir wegen der erhöhten Widerstandskraft auch weniger bis kein Herbizid und Pestizid mehr anzuwenden.
Wirklich?
Ja.
Weil er sich
widerstandsfähiger ist, sich durchsetzen kann, damit gesünderes Wachstum darstellt, ursprünglicheres Wachstum darstellt, das auch ohne Herbizide und Pestizide in der vorindustrialisierten Zeit auskommen musste. Also eben, wie gesagt, es gibt dieses Gerät. Eine Platte wird elektrisch negativ geladen, so dass hier ein statisches E-Feld bei den 4 cm Abstand, die die beiden Platten voneinander haben, von etwa 750 Volt pro Zentimeter entsteht. Ja. Und dieses Feld benötige ich, um Samen, die ich dann in diese Schublade bringen kann, in der ein Vlies ist. Das Vlies mache ich feucht. Dann bringe ich den Samen drauf und bringe den Samen in diese Box, bis diese Samen einen Keimling zeigen. Das heißt, bis die sich vergrößert haben und einen Spross zeigen. Dann nehme ich die raus, setze sie in einen Topf und das war's dann.
I wonder if the crops can retrieve its primal coat. Why shouldn't we? And even though we are so obediently programmed, we remain human, with a DNA that resists oppression, but it's merrily lulled to sleep. Lured into the matrix and adapted to the circumstances of obedience. But things are changing. When suppressed too much, DNA looks for a way out. Always. And even if we often don't fully understand our own rebellion, but merely takes to the streets to correct genetic imbalance. Our DNA awakens, recall its primal structure. The cosmic gate might be opened already. We just have to go through it. But how? I don't know. But as the seed found its goat, so can we.
Und was ist überhaupt die Aufgabe der Mensch?
Die Erde in ihrer Reinheit zu erhalten. Die Erde von alleine braucht es nicht. Aber wir Menschen sind sehr oft so aktiv, dass wir gegen diese Reinheit, bewusst oder unbewusst, vorgehen. Die Aufgabe des Schamane ist, in der ursprünglichen Schwingung die Erde zu halten. Weil die Erde braucht uns. So genau wie wir sie brauchen. Das ist ein Lebewesen, die mit uns in ständigen Austausch, wie Mutter und Kinder. Ja. Ich weiß, es ist vor allem in den Medien wird extrem jetzt diese Zeit zu einer besonderen Zeit erklärt. Daraus wird fast ein eigenes Geschäft gemacht. Sprung der Erde, Übergang, die neue Erde, Bewegung. Und für mein Gefühl, ich kann nicht sagen, dass ich allwissend bin, aber ich kann spüren, was für mich fühlt sich das wie künstliche Konzept draufgesetzt. Also nicht, dass ich den Menschen diese Hoffnung auf etwas ganz Starkes, was passieren darf im Leben, damit wegnehmen möchte. Nur die Suche nicht richtig da, wo, weil das alles passiert in uns innen. Und wenn wir im Inneren etwas verändern, dann verändert sich sofort unsere Realität. Und ja, jetzt, wo wir uns befinden, ist die Chance, dass viele Menschen fast zur gleichen oder zu sehr ähnlich ranliegende Zeit in sich bereit sind, etwas zu verändern. So war vielleicht seit langem nicht mehr die Konstellation auf dieser Erde. Es waren immer so einige Lichtträger, die das kultiviert haben, eben Schamanen auch dazugehörend. Und jeder, der sich auf dem Weg begeben konnte, konnte das in sich aktivieren. Ich habe das Gefühl, dass jetzt ist die Chance, dass sehr viele Menschen fast gleichzeitig, also ich spreche von vielleicht Zeitspanne von 10 Jahren oder, und wenn sich einer von uns in seinem Inneren diese Veränderung anleitet, zu der er steht, zu der er wirklich was sein wahres Selbst bedeutet, dann macht das Boom draußen. Und wenn es mehrere Menschen machen, ich nenne das Springen, man springt sozusagen in sich selbst hinein. Und was für mich weniger wahr ist, die Konzepte im Außen zu suchen, sich irgendwelchen Bewegungen anzuschließen. Oder was ich je höre, in die neue Erde einen Sprung machen. Das klingt so wie aus den Wurzeln herauszugehen. Ein Baum braucht keine neue Erde, der ist mit Wurzel, er hält die Erde. Und mein Gefühl sagt mir auch, dass die sogenannte neue Erde, das ist unsere alte Erde, die wir mit so vielen Schichten bedeckt haben, mit so vielen Mustern, die Fallengedanken bildeten, wo wir uns voll verloren haben. Und der eigentliche Weg ist wieder springen in das, in die Mitte hinein, sozusagen in das tiefste Innere. Ja.
Und stell dir vor, wie dein Steißbein langsam in die Länge wächst, bis in die Erde hinein. Du kannst dich hierfür an den Geruch der Erde erinnern, wie die Erde sich anfühlt. Wenn du magst, kannst du aus deinen Füßen auch noch Wurzeln wachsen lassen. Und dann lass dein Steißbein bis zum Herzen von Mutter Erde wachsen, auch wenn du vom Kopf her nicht weißt, wo dies sein soll. Und dann zieh mit jeder Einatmung ihre heilende, segnende, kräftigende Energie hoch in deinen Körper. Bring es in jede Zelle deines Körpers und darüber hinaus. Und beim Ausatmen gib all das ab, was du nicht mehr brauchst. Alle hinderlichen Vorstellungen, Konzepte, Stress, Schmerzen, auch auf der körperlichen Ebene, Schmerzen auf allen Ebenen, Ängste, Sorgen. Lass all das an dir abfließen und abbröckeln und Mutter Erde wird all dies für dich aufnehmen und umwandeln und dir exakt die Energien jetzt zur Verfügung stellen, die du jetzt brauchst für deinen Weg.
Scale.
And then they're like, wait a minute, they saw the opportunity.
Nobody will be safe if not everybody is vaccinated.
We will all suffer the effects of climate change.
We need more money to plan for the second pandemic.
Are you a boy or a girl?
has rebuilt his chemical and biological weapons stock.
The U.S. and U.K. invaded Iran.
Regardless of where your family farm once was, human beings will not be allowed to set foot in these areas.
In 10 years, we have an implant in our brains.
It won't be men or monkeys.
If you're vaccinated, you can enjoy a typical Thanksgiving meal.
Vaccines had caused heart damage.
For so long, I was in a strange place. Call it middle world. Unrooted and non-spiritual it was. Culture, identity and responsibility were sacrificed for the greater good. But it was a hollow term, accepted through seduction and betrayal, designed to make history and identity disappear and to be swallowed up in the matrix of obedience. It's a game. If you can rob humanity of their true origins, you can make of them whatever you want. And they did. The battlefield is the mind and the prize is the soul. And believe it or not, a game in which we can still decide whether we are playing with them or not.
Kunnen ze het beste aan zichzelf werken? En die kleine omgeving, een kleine community in die eigen dorp of dorpen. De boetewereld is wiet weg. In China, velden en zaak Riesum. En, ja, wat hebben we eraan? Ja, daar hebben ze niks aan. Die informatie, het is verloren. Tijd. Absoluut. Niks.
Maar ja, als er in de deur of in de zak iets in valt.
Ik heb ook niks aan. Maar ik bedoel, maar het begint er al mee dat er paniek gezaaid wordt. Dat er ergens, God weet waar in de wereld, iets gebeurd is wat totaal geen betekenis heeft. Niks.
Het leidt ons af.
Ja.
Birds flying high, you know how I feel. Sun in the sky, you know how I feel. Breeze drifting on by, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life for me.
It is all about coming home. We were distracted from home for so long. And this story is just a reminder of who we are, and if we open ourselves, ancient wisdom will resurface again. We are peaceful human beings from flesh and blood, living on and with a spectacular planet that are giving us all the energy we need if we understand our origin, our local community, and our responsibility. Ignoring the big and embracing the small. Imagine, if we all embrace the small, how big our impact will be. So yes, the fertilizer companies can knock on my door because the copper wire keeps the Colorado beetle out. While just 50 meters away, the potato field without copper wire is a beetle's paradise. It's a new day.
The reason plants start to have illness, right? They start to get like pests and bugs and things like that, is because the bugs and the pests are starting to come in to try to clean up the plant, right? The plant emits infrared and UV frequencies out, and these bugs start coming because the bugs can see these frequencies that are coming from the plant, which is on its way out, right? So what copper starts to do is it starts to restore that energetic principle, and that plant can be stronger and more resilient.
That's the beginning of the concept, because it's vibrating. Everything vibrates at a frequency, and if you know that frequency, you can control things.
Stars, when you shine, you know how I feel. Scent of a pine, you know how I feel. Oh, freedom is mine, I know how I feel.
Om een piramide heen komen soms ook weer planten die je jaren niet gezien hebt. Oude rassen, oude soorten komen ineens weer op. Het zaad kan schijnbaar heel lang stil liggen.
The only thing I'm worried about now is who is going to eat all this.
On the hottest day of the year so far, there's a warning from Wales's top doctor that climate change could be more devastating than COVID for some communities unless we take immediate action.
We now understand that the beast is at the door. We knew this beast of climate change was coming for us. But now it's pounded on the door, and I think it's interesting.
There's a rapid global increase of consciousness. And this is why there's this global manic attempt to depress and reduce our consciousness. Very important for all of us to know what happened. To come to terms with the truth of our past and say, wow, this is unbelievable.
These people really knew a lot about energy, meditation, contemplation of the sky. I think we got very far away from that point. We're reaching this knowledge again. As we don't separate the body and the spirit, they were aware of that. They were in perfect contact with the sky. And we probably are, you know, a dust that came from the sky.
We will have to defend ourselves and conquer until the cosmic gate is open again.
Our minds are currently challenged. Now it's the time where we decide either we stay disciplined, we stay strong, and exchange our slavish mentality for humanity, or we give up.
Der befürchtet, dass in den nächsten Tagen keine Lebensmittel nach Berlin kommen werden.
Na, das ist super.
Na, super schön, dass ihr alle hier seid. Dankeschön, weil es für mich persönlich von großem Wert ist. Wir leben in einer turbulenten Zeit, wo ich mehr und mehr die Fragen gestellt habe, was ist eigentlich Menschsein? Wie sind wir? Wo kommen wir her? Was ist unser Ziel? Wie sieht unsere gemeinsame Horizont aus? Und eine Zeit der Krise gibt uns die Möglichkeit, uns die Fragen zu stellen, mal zurückzuschauen. Und dann stellst du einfach fest, dass wir die Verbindung zu diesen Antworten verloren haben. Weil die können wir nur in einem höheren Bewusstsein finden. Das Universum hat die Antworten, aber wir haben uns schwächen und ablenken lassen durch falsche Versprechen und Erzählungen. Dazu haben wir uns der Angst und die Verlockung falscher Sicherheit selber auch zugelassen, dass wir uns spalten lassen. Aber wie gesagt, eine Krise ist auch immer eine Zeit, wenn wir für die Wahl gestellt werden, dass wir uns entscheiden können, unseren eigenen Weg zu wählen, um unsere Kultur, Unabhängigkeit zu bewahren auf dem Weg nach die Antworten. Und ich glaube, der Weg dahin fängt ganz einfach an. Ich sitze hier mit 20 Leuten an einem Tisch und ich kann 1000 Gründe beargumentieren, was uns trennen kann. Und ich glaube, das ist auch wichtig zu wissen. Aber ich glaube, mehr wichtiger zu wissen, was uns verbinden kann. Und das ist heute den Tisch hier, mit Essen aus eigenem Garten. Solange wir hier an einem Tisch sitzen bleiben, ist das Chance groß, dass wir mit unserer Gruppe das Menschsein nicht verlieren. Und von dort aus die Kräften und Energie zurückgewinnen, die durch den Zahlenzeit einfach verloren gegangen sind.